Okay, we're just moving directly on, and I'm not texting here. I have the bios in my iPhone, so don't worry. So next up is Toby Seay. He's an assistant professor of music industry at Drexel University in Philadelphia. He's had a long career in the music business as a musician, recording engineer, and audio preservationist. He's recorded artists such as Dolly Parton, Randy Travis, and Delbert McClinton. And he has numerous gold and platinum records and has worked on 8 Grammy winners. Toby is the project director at the Drexel University Audio Archives, which is home to the Sigma Sound Studios collection. His research examines how audio preservation practices and standards can inform audio production and education, as well as the effects of studio workflow and recording techniques on music production.
Thank you. Thank you. With that, what I'm going to do today is not show that slide yet. I want to play a lot of clips, so I'm going to try to stick to my script so I can stay on time here. So the title of this presentation is taken from an interview I did last fall with Joe Tarsia, the founder and chief engineer of Sigma Sound Studios in Philadelphia. So first I want to start off with him describing the industry's development in Philadelphia.
And I would say that a lot of the people in the business then got in the business because Dick Clark gave a window of opportunity. I mean, it opened a window. That opened the window for Frankie Avalon, Fabian, Chubby Checker, Bobby Rydell, and that crew. And Kenny Gamble and Leon Huff opened the window for all the R&B acts that came out of Philly and the next wave. And fortunately, I got on the end of one, the beginning of the other.
All right, so what I want to talk about is the second window of opportunity that Tarsia mentioned. Sigma Sound Studios opened its doors for operation in August of 1968 and was the primary site of record production in Philadelphia throughout the 1970s and 1980s. A musical genre that became known as Philadelphia Soul is inextricably associated with Sigma Sound Studios. The forces that developed Philadelphia Soul were already in motion as Gamble and Huff's first national hit, Soul Survivors' Expressway to Your Heart, had been released in 1967. But Joe had created a state-of-the-art facility where the Philadelphia music community would converge to develop a signature sound and a quite prolific musical legacy. This presentation examines audio tapes from the Sigma Sound Studios collection of the Drexel University Audio Archives, which were recorded in the early years of Sigma. From late 1969 to early 1971, the development of Philadelphia soul music and the blending influences of differing musical styles is apparent, with elements of doo-wop, funk, gospel, R&B, soul, with a nod toward what would eventually become disco. I want to start with this recording that can no doubt be classified as Philadelphia Soul. This 1972 quarter-inch half-track recording of Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes, famous If You Don't Know Me By Now, sung by the late Teddy Pendergrass, displays all the elements that made Philadelphia Soul famous: powerful lead vocals, thick vocal harmonies, lush string arrangements, and horn-dominant brass. So it's at this point, 1972, that Kenny Gamble and Leon Huff, Tom Bell, Sigma Sound Studios were firing on all cylinders. Using this recording as a baseline, I want to look at the earlier material from the years prior, which represent the building blocks of the studio and the community's musical output. Here we have a quarter-inch mono mix master from the group of the Four Larks, recorded in August of 1969, only a year after the studio's founding. The tracks It's Unbelievable and Keep On Forgetting were produced by Weldon McDougal, the group's leader. It's Unbelievable was the Larks' first hit with lead singer Jackie Marshall in 1961. They later released It's Unbelievable again in February of 1969 with their new lead singer Vivian McDougal, Weldon McDougal's second wife. His first wife, Cleopatra, was previously in the group as well. Here is yet another remake of the song later that year with an unidentified female singer. So this is kind of rooted in doo-wop. The recording displays the lush verb and orchestration synonymous with Philadelphia soul. Here's It's Unbelievable. Now from November of 1969, this is a quarter-inch half-track stereo audio recording of Nat Turner Rebellion, containing the mixes of the songs Plastic People and Tribute to a Slave. These recordings were made for Philly Groove Records and were released on the Del Valiant label. Taking its name from Nat Turner, who led the famous Slave Rebellion of 1831, the Nat Turner Rebellion uses black power and marijuana culture themes within funk music form. Musically, these tracks display powerful horn sections, electric sitar, and psychedelic lyrics that were staples of late 60s funk music. Seven days later, this Gamble and Huff production of Sweet Inspirations for the 1970 Atlantic Records album release Sweet Sweet Soul displays a recording that sounds more Stax than it does Philly Soul, while containing electric sitar again, and electric piano, often used in funk and disco. These recordings have a big horn section but no strings. Having an Aretha Franklin type of vibe, this recording was made only a month after Sissy Houston left the group. Here is Two Can Play the Game. Now, released on Wand Records for John Madara Enterprises, this quarter-inch half-track stereo recording from December of 1969 features the song Pity the Poor Man by George Tinley. Referred as Northern Soul, this recording features the smooth vocal arrangements synonymous with soul music with upbeat rhythms that would later become an element of disco. Prominent in this mix is vibraphone, which is a staple in Philadelphia music production and is probably performed by Vince Montana. Here's Pity the Poor Man.
Walking through the jungle, love your ups and downs. Never handed out a smile, handed out a frown. I never had that trouble with my baby's love, because we stick together like fingers in a glove. Give my woman what she wants. Oh,
Now we move on to some multi-track. Here is a one-inch eight-track production recording of Holly Maxwell, produced by Ronald Baker, Norman Harris, and Earl Young. Baker, Harris, and Young were part of the main rhythm section for many recording Sigma recordings, bass, guitar, and drums, respectively. The two songs on this tape, Never Gonna Love Again and Winter Go Away, were the A and B sides of a seven-inch release on Smith-Witt Records. The production of Never Gonna Love Again demonstrates classic Philly soul, big string and big horn sections along with soaring background vocals. But again, stuck in there a little bit is, again, electric sitar and some electric piano. Here's Never Gonna Love Again. In January of 1970, this one-inch eight-track production was released as the A and B sides of a seven-inch release for White Whale Records and was produced by Ross Newman for GRT. The brothers, too, were the singing duo of James Tindall and Eddie Smalls. The two songs in this tape, My Sweetness and Hoping, again, are more reminiscent of Stax artists such as Sam and Dave or Wilson Pickett, rather than the smoother Philadelphia soul of the time. With soulful guitar licks and bright horn parts, the brothers, too, performed easily danceable, upbeat duets. This sounds a little older than the time period it was recorded. Later in 1970, on September, this is a quarter-inch stereo recording containing the mixes for the mood song King Hustler for Scepter Records. This track, along with the song With the Woman, was released as a 7-inch single in 1970. The Moods, formerly known as the Volcanoes, were transitioning from 60s funk to what would become 70s disco. Members of the Moods would later form the band The Tramps, who would go on to stardom with their hit Disco Inferno. Here, the song King Hustler describes an urban scene of South Street, Philadelphia, where the lyrics proclaim, "I used to be a hustler, but now I'm a lover." The track relies on funk rhythms, active bass parts, and dominant horns in establishing a more aggressive side of Philadelphia music production. Here is King Hustler. From March 1971, this recording of Lynn Berry of 1-2-3 fame was for Vanguard Records, but was never released until decades later when it was included on the Best of Philly Soul Volume 1. Sigma Sound Studios adopted the 2-inch 16-track format in late 1970. Though the track count had doubled from 8 to 16, the production methods remained consistent with earlier Sigma recordings. On this song, Lazy Susan, on the songs Lazy Susan and Girl You're Too Young, which was originally recorded by Archie Bell and the Drells, producer Tom Bell and engineer Joe Tarsia capture a string section, horn section, rhythm section, all playing live. Here, Lynn Berry's Blue-Eyed Soul is combined with lush string arrangements and large room ambience due to a lot of microphone spill that made Philadelphia Soul famous. Staying on 2-inch 16 track, this is one that I found that intrigued me a lot because I found very little information about it. But it was produced by Norman Harris for Sandbag Records in April of 71. A 2-inch 16 track tape contains the songs Thinking About My Baby and Don't Fight the Feeling by the Geminiles. This vocal group explore soul and funk on these two tracks. Thinking About My Baby is classic vocal group soul with lush strings and French horn. While Don't Fight the Feeling is upbeat funk with bright horns and driving congas. Here's Don't Fight the Feeling. Coming back around to the Philadelphia soul sound, finally, this quarter-inch stereo master is the first Stylistics record created with their new producer Tom Bell for their new record label, Avco. Tom Bell had previously produced hit records with the Delphonics. Here, with lyricist Linda Creed, the top 10 hit Stop, Look, Listen to Your Heart is recorded and mixed by Joe Tarsia in April of 1971. Along with Stop, Look, and Listen, is the song If I Love You. These two songs were the first and last tracks on the Stylistics' self-titled album release of 1971. Here one can hear lush strings, horn arrangements, along with the falsetto vocals of Russell Tompkins Jr. that helped define smooth Philadelphia soul music. Here's Stop, Look, and Listen. So this is but a small selection of recordings from the Sigma Sound Studios collection. However, the momentum from this window of opportunity that Tarsia spoke of from late 1969 to early 1971 and the impressively prolific output of Sigma Sound Studios is apparent. While all the ingredients that make up Philadelphia's soul music are in full swing, there are many stories to be told within these recordings, and I hope you enjoyed this small glimpse into the collection. Thank you. You have any questions? Yes.
I'm curious of the 8-track tapes that you show tracks that are scrammed out. Are they recorded and not used in the mix?
Let me go back and see if I can see. Those are probably takes. No, those were the track sheets. Yeah.
Can I go back one more?
Okay.
There, see now.
Yes. So what you have on this, and I can barely see it on my screen because it's so tiny, there are 12 takes of that first song.
Yeah, I
don't
look upon
the yeah. So when you look at the tracks, what is crossed out was probably what was recorded on the basic tracks before they bounced to then add extra overdubs. So what you see is what is on track, on take number 12. And so they scribbled some things out because they moved around and got subgrouped and submixed together. And that's the final. What's that now? They might have, but generally what they would did a lot of bouncing to add space for other tracks. I don't know if they. Yeah, no, they did a lot of takes. From talking with the Sigma folk, and we have one here with Mike Spitz from ATR, and yeah, so what we have is a kind of a culture of performance rather than manufacture. So from this period of time, that was extremely obvious that they were trying to get a performance first rather than. Right. Exactly. Any other questions? Yes.
I was wondering how much detail you had using the track list and like about the recording session, how it progressed, how they balanced, you know, technical or
very little, other than the track, what's on the track sheet, what you're seeing here. Take sheets, track sheets. That's about it. Over time, there are some notes placed on track sheets, what microphones were used, whatnot. You have to kind of do a little detective work to see how it was bounced together. On top of that, I can go back to some of the creators, and they might have some recollection on things. But what you see with a reel of tape and that piece of paper, if there's something else written on the box, that's the information that I have.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So how did you come into possession of the
vault? Well,
the record companies, they just ended up in the vault?
No. They just ended up in the vault. What we have is what was left over when the studio ceased operations. They tried their best to get people to record labels to come and get their stuff. The ones that did came and got it. The ones that didn't, they were left over. And they decided to donate it to Drexel, since we have a music industry program, which made a lot of sense. But what we have are some remnants. I was talking to Kenny Gamble. They pretty much have all of their materials, except for a few things that got left behind. And he's got over 15,000 reels of tape. And I only have like 6,200. But in there are these nice little gems that kind of, to me, paint a really interesting picture. Anybody else? Yeah.
Were these the clips, were they from the original releases or new transfers?
These were all from transfers.
New transfers.
Except for, I have to admit, that all of the multi-tracks that I'm showing here, I show because I have the multi-tracks and I really like the multi-tracks. I also have the mix masters. So what you're hearing is the transfer of the quarter inch. Because it was either that or B, remix it for demonstration purposes, and what's the point? So that's the only thing that might differ from what you see. But these are all fresh transfers. Yes?
How are the condition of the tapes?
They're in really good shape. Surprisingly, considering they spent a number of years in a storage facility, a non-climate controlled storage facility in downtown Philly. There are a selection of tapes that were stored up against a concrete block wall that do have some mold issues. The tape's fine, but they do have a little mold growth. We have kept them in really low humidity for. Well, we got the tapes in 05. So from that point on, they have become really stable, other than the few, and they use scotch a lot. And that is really stable compared to, you know, every once in a while we'll sneak in an Ampex reel, and it inherently will be sticky, but not ridiculously so. It doesn't take a lot. So that's a blessing. Yes?
Was this all what Joe gave you?
There is some outside stuff. Later you will find a few tapes where the legend has the two addresses, the Sigma New York, Sigma Philly, and one of them will be checked off. So there is some stuff that came from Sigma New York. There's some stuff that came from other places anyway. Alpha Recording, which was also in Philly. There are some studios I have never heard of from around Philly that ended up there. And I look at the map and think of, you know, what it would have been like having a recording studio in that neighborhood, and what that neighborhood must have definitely been different than it is now. So yeah, there's a lot of outside stuff. I actually, the oldest reel of tape I have in the collection is from 1967, which predates Sigma, and it came from New York. So actually from Bell Studios. So. Anybody else? All right, thank you very much.